Well, good morning. We've got our Bibles this morning, please. Let's turn to the Old Testament and to the book of Jonah. To the book of Jonah. And I'll give you a few moments to find that in the Old Testament, please. I heard someone one time preaching from one of the minor prophets' books. And he said that he would give everyone a chance just to find where it was at. He says, I would hate to get to heaven and Jonah, etc., to ask you, did you read my book? And he says, no, I did not. Sure, the minister never gave me time to find it. So I'm not going to give you that excuse. Let's turn to Jonah, please. Jonah chapter 1. It's just a short reading from chapter 1, verse 1. It says here, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof, and went down into it, to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Just those three verses, we'll maybe read them through again, just so we understand the passage. It says, and the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah arose and to flee up unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Finishing our reading there at verse number 3. Let's bow together. A moment of prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for our meeting this morning. We're thankful for these lovely hymns that we've been singing together. Arise, my soul, arise. Lord, we pray, Lord, that this morning that you'll help us to arise. Not to arise as Jonah did here, but arise in doing. Arise in action for what you're calling us for. Lord, we're thankful as we're singing the first hymn that was love divine, all loves excelling. We're thankful for the great love that you have shown to this world and the great love that you have shown to us as individuals. But Lord, we pray for that great love to be applied to souls this morning, that men and women will understand their need of forgiveness, that understand their need of repentance. And Lord, that the amazing love and the amazing grace will flow mightily down upon our place this morning, we pray. Lord, we ask for this portion that we have read. Lord, I ask for your help as we endeavor now to look upon it, to expound upon it, we pray. I ask for your filling once again. Fill me with your spirit, I pray. And Lord, be none be seen save Jesus only, we pray. For we do ask it in your precious name. Amen. Amen. I've been thinking much recently about the great commission that falls upon each and every one of us as a Christian child of God. Mark 16 tells us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And you know, with that in mind, I was talking to someone just last weekend, and it was that verse that seemed to trouble them greatly. They were very troubled when they thought upon that verse, and she was that concerned. She says, what have I got to be able to offer to God? She says, what can I do for God? I can't speak publicly. She says, I find it very hard to witness. She says, what use has God got for me? But you see, Christian, that commission still falls on every one of our lives. The commission still falls upon every Christian child of God. And friend, it's called our testimonies. It's called our testimonies. It's called how we live our lives in front of other people. A commission to examine what God has done in our lives, and it's a commission to pass it on even by living out our lives in front of this old world. Whether it's standing behind a pulpit, whether it's standing on a street corner proclaiming the gospel, whether it's preaching, teaching, outreaching, whatever it is, we have a commission upon our lives, whether it's taking our stand in front of our families. You see, the word preach in that verse, to preach the gospel, means to publish abroad. It means to herald abroad what God has done in our lives. If we're saved this morning, surely we have a duty in front of us to tell others. We have a duty to show what God has done in our lives to those that are watching all around about us. Like the starving lepers that we read about in the Old Testament who found that food, they knew they had a duty to go and to tell others of what they had. God asks us to be faithful. God asks us to be faithful in telling others what he has done in our lives. Wasn't Jesus faithful to the will of God when he went to Calvary? Jesus was faithful. It tells us in Luke 22, it says, "If thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." He says in Philippians 2 and verse 8, he says, "Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of a cross." Why? Because 2 Peter 3 and 9 says he was not willing that any should perish. Christian, we have an onus on our lives. We have a need in our lives to tell others. Others that perhaps won't be found in gospel preaching churches. Others that won't read their Bible for themselves. And we have a duty to live our Christian walk and our testimony out in front of them. Jesus moved in obedience to God's will and God's word on this earth. That's the calling that we have in our life. With those thoughts on our mind, my thoughts were drawn very especially to this opening few verses of Jonah. We'll use that as our title this morning, In Answer to God's Calling. In answer to God's calling, if this morning, if God's people would take this on board even for their own lives, and I mean that for the benefit of each and every believer here this morning, prepared to seek God, prepared to understand what God has for that life of yours. What is God's calling for your life? Have you searched for God's calling on your life? Are you prepared for God's calling on your life? And let me say this, that there's a difference in being prepared for God's calling on your life and knowing what God's calling is in your life. Because immediately, as soon as we read this portion of Jonah, as soon as we read out this morning that we're reading from the prophet Jonah, immediately our thoughts will go first of all to his disobedience. Our thoughts go immediately to how he was told to go and he disobeyed God. You see, Jonah knew what his calling was, but he wasn't prepared for it. And so there's a difference. To know the calling on our life and to be prepared for the calling on his life. And all we'll remember for Jonah is how he set off in disobedience. We'll understand how he received the great commission from God. And we'll understand how he fled from the presence of God. He went down into Joppa. He got onto that ship. He ended up in the depths of the ocean, in the belly of a great fish, knowing the call, but not being prepared for the call. But you know, another way of looking at this man, Jonah, is by realizing that this was a man who was in contact with God. A man who was in contact with God. A man who was a prophet. A man who had contact with God, most likely many times in his life. And God came to Jonah with a task that needed carried out. And Jonah lived during the reign of Jeroboam II. He was a prophet to carry the word of God to the nations. And in this cause, we read here in verse number 2, it says, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it." This was the great task that God gave over to Jonah. Praise God. Even though this was God's message and even though it was refused, praise God, it wasn't the end for this man. You see, God's graciousness prevailed. The hymn writer could say there's a wideness to God's mercy that is deeper than the deepest sea. The very fact that he was a prophet meant that he was waiting on God's instruction. He was waiting on God's instruction. He was waiting for his task to be given to him, but he couldn't go through with it when it came. Christian, this morning, can we take the high ground on him? Can we take the high ground on Jonah this morning? How many of us are guilty of the exact same thing? How many of us are willing to pray for God's calling on our lives? And when God gives us that calling, how many of us won't or can't step forward with the next part of his plan? What do we notice about the opening verses? Look at verse number 1. What do we notice about the calling? First thing we can see here is the word now. It says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai. You see, God spoke in his timing. God spoke in his timing. This wasn't man's timing. God's word came to the prophet in his timing. It was God who set the timing of this calling. It wasn't orchestrated by Jonah. It came in God's timing. It says now. But look again, verse number 1. It says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai. And that's special to note that. Not only in God's time, but Jonah wasn't going to be going in his own strength. We read here it was in God's timing with God's message. Christian, what do you have to fear? What do we have to fear when we receive a message such as this? That it was in God's timing with God's words. Now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah. Christian, this morning, have you been searching for directions and reluctant to move? Have you been asking for guidance and fearful for the message that you've been receiving? You see, if God's speaking, God's stirring, it's for your benefit. It's for your benefit. You see, God speaks when we search for him. God speaks when we take time to listen. God speaks to those who are in communion with him. Those that are interceding with God. And I believe Jonah perhaps was a man who searched for God to speak. Even a man in communion, but a man who failed to handle the calling he received. But you know, it's the calling that Jonah received that I want to consider in the time that we have remaining. You see, Jonah received 3 commands from God. Orders that were intended to move the man of God in God's perfect timing. And we find them there in verse number 2. 3 commands. He says, arise, go, cry. 3 commands that he handed over to Jonah. He says, arise. He says, go to Nineveh. And he says, cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. We'll take each command separately and consider them. Or one of them, depending how time goes. But as we enter this portion, isn't it comforting to know that God's eyes are not blind today? Isn't it comforting to know, Christian, and believers here together, that God's eye is still not blind to what's going on in this old world? And sometimes we need to be reminded of that. We look around in today's world and all we can see is that sin seems to be prevailing. And we look around and we think to ourselves that evil in mankind is getting away with all sorts. We see all sorts of disobedience to God's intended purpose for life, for society, for government. We tend to think to ourselves that God's doing nothing about it. And yet here we come to Nineveh and we see in God's timing, he releases those powerful words in verse number 2. He says, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it. Listen to the words he says, for their wickedness is come up before me. Oh, God sees the wickedness in this world. He sees the wickedness today. He knows exactly what's going on in this world today. He sees the abuse of his creation by his creation. He sees the immorality of this hour. But friend, God will move in his time. God will move in his time, and so then should we. Not before it, not after it, but when God speaks. And it's that first word I want us to consider this morning. That first command, arise, that we read in verse number 2. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, cry against it, for their wickedness has come up against me. You see, we have a mental picture in our heads at what that word arise means. Remember, though, we're dealing with a Hebrew text here when we're reading through the Old Testament. Taking that into account, we have a terrific picture of what Jonah is being called to do here. But more than that, it transfers down through the years. It's a picture of what God calls each and every one of us to do. We started with that great commission that's on each and every one of our lives. And with the same word, arise, we can take it to ourselves this morning. Let's consider the translations. Firstly, arise, and we'll say it means get out. A time of stirring. A time of stirring. Arise. It's a picture of waking someone from their bed in the morning. Arise. Was Jonah lazing about at this time of his ministry? You see, as you know yourselves, with human beings, getting them awakened out of their sleep will take longer for some people than it will for others. You see, God needed this man awake. God needed him awake. He needed him alert. He needed him ready. How long did God have to stir him? How long did God have to stir Jonah here? To stir him awake, alert, ready? Was Jonah inactive when he should have been active? But now God comes in his time. God starts to stir this man. Starts to wake him from maybe from the slumber that he's in. Maybe God's saying to someone this morning the same thing. Maybe he's stirring someone into action. Maybe he has been stirring someone into action. How long will God have to stir? How long will God have to stir us awake, alert, ready? Isn't it sad that Jonah needed to be stirred? He needed to be stirred. Perhaps it's a foresight of the second arise that we see in verse number 6. Maybe he knew what God was going to say to him. He didn't want that task. Maybe he viewed another task as more important. Oh, Christian, whatever God is stirring you for, listen to him. Whatever God's dealing with in your heart and he's starting to stir you, don't view something else as more important. Don't worry about what that other thing is. When God says arise, it's time to arise. Get out, a time of stirring. Secondly, get up, a time of moving. It also translates as a time to move. So with the stirring already done, this translation gives Jonah the next step. He says, arise. He says, move. God's saying, Jonah, he says, it's now time. It's now time, Jonah. It's now time to move. I've waited long enough with Nineveh. I have watched as the evil and wickedness have come up right to my very face. I have seen it long enough. He says, Jonah, it's time to go. It's time to move. And this translation gives us the picture of God telling Jonah, literally, he says, get up. Get up. Arise. It's time to go. Why? He says, I'm ready to move. He says, I'm ready to move. I'm ready to show you this plan. Christian, can God say that to you this morning? Can he say that to you this morning? The time of stirring has passed. God's ready to move. He's ready to show you the next step of the plan. You're not being stirred any longer. Now he's saying your commission's ready. Your commission's ready. The next step is coming. Perhaps that's something God has been showing someone. Maybe you've been stirred in previous meetings. Maybe God has been stirring a desire in your heart, stirring a commission in your heart. And up until this point, that's all it's been. It's just been a gentle stirring. But now God's coming a little bit more forcefully. And now he's saying, it's time to move. Time to move. And maybe even this morning you can hear God's voice saying, he says, you know what? He says, I'm ready. He says, I'm ready. I'm ready to show you the next step. Are you ready? But saying God's ready to move isn't the only translation here. Because listen to it. It can also be translated as God is ready to move again. God is ready to move again. Praise God that he's not limited this morning. If God has moved once, God can move again. He's moved in revival before. He can move in revival again. He has saved souls by the hundreds before. He can save by the hundreds again. God has stirred souls stuck deep in the mire of sin before, and praise God, he can do it again. Unsaved soul, God is ready to move. He's ready to move in salvation in your life. Will you allow him? And maybe there's someone in our meeting this morning. And maybe he's saying, you know what? He says, I want you to be instrumental in doing that. I need you to be instrumental in doing it. He's used you before. He can use you again. Are you ready? Are you ready to see him move? Are you willing to see him move? You know, God doesn't always have to stir the first timers into action. Sometimes he needs to stir those that have been on the road for a long time. Have you been praying to that end? Have you been praying that God will have that task just for you? Have you been praying that God will be able to use you once again? Have you been praying that God has a task for you to carry out once again? God is ready to move. He's ready to move again. Get out a time of stirring. Get up a time of moving. Maybe it's get going a time of confirming. A time of confirming. God says, arise. This time the word arise is translated as a direct order straight from God. Arise. You have waited long enough. This is your confirmation. You have waited long enough. This is your confirmation. Christian, this morning, maybe you've been praying for direction. Maybe you've been asking for an avenue in your life. And God has been saying, no more waiting. Maybe it's not a stirring that you need. Maybe it's not instruction that you need. Maybe it's this is what you need to hear. Maybe you need to hear, arise. This is your confirmation. This is the confirmation of the message that I have been giving to you. You see, I believe we as Christians are so daunted by the next step that we fear to face it. We get ourselves all nice and cozy. We know we're saved. We know that Jesus has set us free from the chains of sin. And we seem to get ourselves nice and comfy. And we get ourselves cozy. We know we're on our way to heaven and to home. And that'll do me just fine. We don't always want to know the next step that God has for us. We don't want to know about the next commission. Maybe that's what Jonah was doing. Because God had it come to him. He had to come in verse number 2. He had to say, arise, Jonah. He says, Jonah, I've been looking at Nineveh. I've seen Nineveh. I know what Nineveh's like. He says, now it is time to move. And each one of us this morning as Christians, there isn't one person in here this morning would deny that if I said we all want to hear God's voice. Not one person would argue with me on that. We want to hear God's voice. We want to know God's will. But we hold back and we hold back and we're afraid to take the next step. We're not alone. We're not alone. Moses was the exact same. You see, Moses was afraid when God gave him that great commission. God said to Moses to go and lead my people, to go down into Egypt, to go and speak to the Egyptians, to release my people. He tried every avenue he could to try and hold back God's plan. He blamed every inadequacy he had, every excuse that could roll off his tongue for why he wasn't the man for the job seemed to come very, very easily to him. And he argued with God in some vain attempt for God's will to pass him by. Oh, he looked at his own limitations. He failed to see the strong hand of God that was by his side. Christian, I would rather be nervous in God's will than comfortable outside it. Rather to be nervous stepping out knowing that the strong arm of God was by my side than sitting comfy and cozy outside of God's will. What about Gideon? Same thing. Gideon tried every avenue he could to try and hold back God's plan for his life. He blamed himself. He blamed his family. He blamed the weakness of his family. He looked to his own limitations again instead of looking to the God that was with him. And I'll say it again, Christian, I would rather be nervous in God's will than comfortable outside it. What have we got to fear? What have you got to fear? If you have been praying and asking God for direction and guidance, and you have spent time asking God for that direction and for that guidance, and God has moved and shown it to you, what have you got to fear? You see, God could come here, chapter 1, verse 1, it says, now, in God's timing, now the word of the Lord, God's words. God's words in God's time. If I'm speaking to someone this morning, then remember this call from God to Jonah. He says, Jonah, arise. He says, this is your confirmation. This is your confirmation. Think on the call to Moses. He said pretty much the same thing to Moses. He says, Moses, it's time to arise. He says, this is your confirmation. This is your next step. He said the same thing to Gideon. He says, Gideon, it's time for your next step. Jonah, Moses, Gideon, no more stirring. He said, it's time to move. He says, this is your confirmation. I want you to go. Get out, a time of stirring. Get up, a time of moving. Get going, a time of confirming. What about get into? A time of engaging. A time of engaging. Friend, arise. Engage in the battle. You see, the battle's raging this morning. The enemy's regrouping. The arrows are flying. Warriors are falling. And sad to say, souls are dying. Souls are dying. And souls are dropping into a lost eternity as I speak this morning. You tell me that you'd rather be comfortable outside the will of God? Or nervous in the battle. But when we're in God's will, God's with us. What does this translation mean? Arise also means, he says, it's time to engage. It's time to engage. Think of what that must have been like for Jonah. As Jonah waited on the next step from God, and this word came across his life, God says, Jonah, he says, arise. Oh, this was a battlefield, all right, for Jonah. It was a battlefield. He was heading to the great city of Nineveh. The hymn writer could say, O church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ, our captain. You see, the battlefield was ready. So was his mission field. And I'll tell you something, don't differentiate between the two. Don't differentiate between the two, because whenever we enter the mission field in our families, in our workplaces, in our towns and villages, or where God has called you to, when God calls you into the mission field and you step out against Satan and every attack that he has and you take a stand against him, you're stepping into the battlefield. You're stepping into a battlefield. And if it isn't a battlefield, then we're not damaging the work of Satan. You see, he doesn't worry about entertainment coming from our church pulpits instead of a gospel service, a gospel message. He doesn't care about some old watery sermon instead of the blood of Calvary. He doesn't care about churches playing churches for the sake of it. I was reading this week about the Elvis impersonator that performed in a church. An Elvis impersonator standing in the pulpit of a church. Was he entering a battlefield? Of course he wasn't. Of course he wasn't. And the headlines in the paper reading that the church was all shook up. I'm telling you, it wasn't the Spirit shook them up anyway. Do you think he was in a battlefield? Of course he wasn't. A pile of nonsense when souls were dropping into a lost eternity. Dropping into eternity with our next breath, unwarned, unreached. Wasn't taking God's message that would change the world. Entertaining numbers, tickling ears to boost numbers. God wasn't calling Jonah to do this. God wasn't calling Jonah to tickle the ears of the people. God wants a man who would stand in the gap. Enter the battlefield. Christian, are you the person that God's looking for? I think it was Leonard Ravenhill who said that people today need to have their ears tickled. And he says, I don't have a commission for God to do that. If God's calling you into the mission field, into the battlefield, be prepared to go with God's words. Why was this such a battlefield for Jonah? Satan was roaring. Satan was roaring, just like today. Christian, take heart. You see, Jonah was going with God's words, in God's timing, into God's mission field. You couldn't have got much more perfect than that. God's words, in God's time, into God's mission field. Verse 2, it says, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me." This was the most important city in Assyria. The rising power of the day. The nation that would later take Israel into a nation that would take Israel into captivity. And within 50 years, Assyria would become the nation's capital. It says here, "For their wickedness is come up before me." Nineveh wasn't a holiday destination. Their wickedness was great. Christian, this morning, the world is not our holiday home. The world is not a holiday destination for us. We have work to do. We have work to do. If we had time this morning, we could go into Nahum. Nahum 1 and 9, find out what Nineveh was like. Tells us all the imaginations that the people had against God. We could find out what they were like in Nahum 3 and verse 4 of some of the acts that they were getting up to. And when you read those, can you blame Jonah for not wanting to go into the battlefield? Of course not. Of course not. But there was something different, because God was saying, "Arise." God was saying, "Arise." Christian, this morning, it's just the same for us. We mightn't want to step into an area of the work. We mightn't even feel adequate to step into some area of the work, but there's no excuse for us not to be there if God has called you to be there. What's your excuse if God has already called you there? Jonah grew up knowing all about the Assyrians. I'm sure he grew up fearing the Assyrians, wondering why God wasn't dealing with all the evilness around them. But at the end of the day, there were souls needing salvation. They were souls that needed God's grace. We live in a world today every bit as evil. Every bit as wicked, every bit as defiant in their stance against God, but they are still souls in need of salvation. Are we prepared to take God's word to them? Are we prepared to show them their need of salvation? Or like Jonah, can we stand back and say, God, use me anywhere, anywhere but Nineveh? Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee, but not there. Where he may lead me, I will go, for I have learned to trust him so, but I'm not going there. One word of commission is what God gave to Jonah. He said, arise. Arise. One word meant so much for Jonah when he had to consider the immense task that lay ahead of him. Arise. Jonah felt vastly unprepared, even a defiance in taking God's word forward. Friends, unless we see the mission field, the battlefield, unless we see it as souls in need of salvation, we're making the same mistakes as Jonah did. We're making the same mistakes. Oh, we can say we're ready for the next step. And we can pray to God to show us the next step. And we can plead that God will have a task for us and give us the next step in our Christian walk. But if we're not prepared to see souls in need of salvation, and we're prepared to pick and choose who hears the message, God said, arise. Arise. Not just get up. He was saying, arise. He says, get out. A time of stirring. He says, get up. A time of moving. He says, get going. A time of confirming. He says, get into. The time of engaging. Amen.